Goals, the big C, confident. Do you think it puts your confidence up?
Yes, it gives you practice on what to say.
Ooh, I love that word, practice. I mean, how many times, I remember when I'm the former world's worst salesperson. Good morning, Christina. Smile. Let me see that smile. Come on. There it is. Okay, good. Be happy, people. Come on. It's life. Celebrate it. The more you practice, the better you get. How many times, I remember when I first started sales, they'd ask me these questions and I'd get nervous and I'd stutter. I still stutter. And things like that. And what do you think when someone, when you practice and you have the presence of mind to first stroke them? Hey, great question. Somebody asked me a question. Alex, ask me a good real estate or something question.
Hey, Claude, what color are your socks?
You know what? I love that you asked that question. That's a great question. Now, that's funny you said that because it's summer. I'm not wearing any socks.
That's right. Trick question.
A trick question. Now, you must have asked that for a reason. Well, you're not, you know, are you studying to be a podiatrist or something, or?
No, just seeing if you needed some flip-flops is all.
Oh, I do. Actually, this is off the record. I run every day 10 miles. I run in sandals because they're so comfortable. Your foot doesn't get hot, and you're not pronated. Like some of these shoes make you go high and low. I run in a pair. It's called Luna sandals. Luna. Go to luna.com. It's a really great company, and I can run 10, 20 miles in a pair of sandals, and it's really comfortable. Although you do get dirty feet. Yuck. Okay. Enough about my feet. Alex started it. I'm sorry. He gave me a topic, and I can roll with it. Should we talk about feet for 60 minutes?
No, run away from that.
No. Let's segue and everything. The first thing I did when Alex asked that question, great. I think I said something like, great question. Oh, I'm really glad you brought that up and everything. So how important is it when you practice to first acknowledge somebody? Hey, I'm listening to you. Great question. Glad you brought it up. What happens when we acknowledge people? How does that make them feel? Come on.
Important.
Important.
Yeah. It makes them feel good. It makes them feel important.
Validated.
They're part of your tribe or whatever, right?
Yes.
So stroking and nurturing, we don't talk enough. You got to acknowledge them and do that. But the practice makes perfect. And role playing, if we go over some of the 10, 20 most common stalls, objections, questions that your prospects are asking, and we role play it, and we put in a little bit of that gut psychology and a little bit of thespian skills, acting skills. We're going to get better and better, aren't we, through repetition? What Helen said
Yes.
earlier. Somebody say yes.
Yes.
I
You
need
can make mistakes with you, and then we won't blow the deal.
Yeah. How important is confidence? I said that word earlier. We talk about that once in a while. Good morning, G. Good morning, Gonzalo. How you doing, buddy? There's this million-dollar smile.
Hey, I'm doing good, Claude.
That's
Thanks.
great, man. Where are you right now?
Mexico.
Okay.
Yeah.
Donde está la cuatro de baño? Una cerveza, por favor. Una margarita sin sal.
Yeah,
That's
you ready? Come on down.
I said the three things.
Everybody knows this phrase.
What was that?
Everybody knows just this phrase.
The only thing you need to know in any language is where's the bathroom and can I have a beer or a margarita without salt? Those are the three things.
That's it. That's all, just to survive. That's all you need.
Or just say, you don't even have to say the donde está la cuarto de baño. You have to just say baño, baño.
Yeah.
And please and thank you.
Right? And please and thank you. What happens when you go to a different culture? Jessica, you just travel a lot. What happens? You go to a different culture, they know you don't speak the language, but you show respect. You say please and thank you.
Yes, I learned how to say hello, goodbye, please, thank you, and
What
for
happens though?
me.
What do you think? Somebody who knows you're visiting their country, and they know you don't speak the language, but you're trying at least to show respect and be
Yes.
polite. What do you what goes through their head?
Like this guy appreciates me. He cares about me. He right. cares that he's trying, yeah. And trying with the accent and the dialect, you know?
Yeah.
Yeah, you don't become the ugly American, you know, when you're traveling. You don't expect the rest of the world to acquiesce to your culture and your language all the time. Boy, I had a hell of a time in France, though. My French is, it's bad. It's real bad. Anyway, so we're talking, role playing is important because it gives us the practice. Who's got a role player? What's the biggest stall objection? What's the question that you folks are asked the most in your?
Claude, yesterday I dealt with a gatekeeper. He said he was a property manager. And I basically was answering, he wanted to answer all the questions. So how would you deal with that situation?
Well, let's turn it around. I'm gonna answer a question with a question, which is kind of guts psychology here. Why do you think he didn't want to answer the questions? Why do you think he reacted that way? You're a nice guy. You were very polite. How come he reacted that way?
Maybe the trust wasn't just there.
Well, he doesn't. You're a stranger. He doesn't know who you are. You're coming out of left field. I want to ask you a whole bunch of questions and cross-examine you and pick your brain for information. Do you think that might have been his perception, Jen?
Probably. I called him because the property was on Zillow for sale by owner. So when I called, he picked up and he was like, I'm the property manager. We're asking for this. So, but I did the agenda and he was, everything was going well. It was just, I had to go through him for all the details.
What's his incentive he's a property manager. Now, remember, his company's going to lose the management of that property if you buy that property, am I correct in that assumption?
Oh, they're looking to sell the property.
I'm not sure
if I get your... I didn't get your question.
Okay, so the management company, as a service to I assume this is a condo, as a service to its customers, also helps them sell it. Okay, he doesn't have a good connection, so I'm gonna just kind of wing it here.
Okay, I'm sorry.
It's okay. We can't hear you that well. Bottom line is you've got to put yourself in their shoes, almost mind reading. What does that property manager want? Is that person going to get a commission? Is there some reward for that person? And can you say, you know, I'd like to make, hi, Mr. Property Manager, Vic, the property manager. Vic, unmute yourself there. Vic, you're the property manager there. And I understand you have a property for sale. It couldn't be available still, is it?
Yeah, it's still available. How can I help you?
I want to make an offer on that today. Are you the right guy to talk to? Can you make a decision on that today?
I'll have to speak to the property owners, but go ahead and shoot your offer.
Okay. Can I speak directly to the property owner to convey my offer here? Or are you the middleman on this deal?
Yeah, well, yeah, the owners do want to sell it, so I can just, relay them your information, but... Just by any chance, so what offer are you getting? Because a bunch of these calls.
That's great. I'm seriously looking for a property. I want to make an offer today, but I'd like also to know if I make an offer today, I'd like to get an answer back today. Can you accommodate me?
Yeah, I can do that for you, Claude.
You're a good man. Thank you, sir. Can I just ask two or three quick questions on the property? I'll make you an offer. I can do it verbally. I'll put it in writing. And hopefully before 4:30 today, you can get back to me and let me know, okay?
Go ahead, Claude. You seem like a nice guy. I like doing business with people like you.
I fool people all the time. They always think I'm a nice guy. it's acting skills. Off the role play. That's Jan, if you can hear me. Did you sound a little bit like that, where you hit his incentive, his hot button right away? Would you like to sell it today? Do you have the authority? I want to buy it today. I want to make an offer today. Am I creating an urgency in this guy?
Yes.
Okay. So you see, the trouble is they get a lot of phone calls. Hi, I saw the ad. I want to ask you a million questions and everything. And this person has had 10 people call already. They're not enthusiastic about wasting another half hour on the phone with someone they know nothing about, right? So what's the first thing I do when I get somebody on the phone in a situation like this? What's the first thing I said?
I'd like to make an offer.
Yes, thank you, Albert. Yes, I want to make an offer today. Okay, so is there anything wrong with that? I can make offers, he can say no. But what are they hearing when I say I can, what are they thinking when I say I can make an offer now, today?
You mean business.
I mean business, thank you, Jessica, yes. Okay, oh, I saw your ad, I'd like to ask you a million questions and then I'll think about it. I'll go light a candle in church. I'll get back to you in the near distant future. You imagine getting calls like that all day long? Is it any reason that we get this really high rejection rate from people? So put a little enthusiasm in it, a little panache into it. A question. Somebody had a question before, I believe. Anybody?
Yeah, I mean, I have a question that's kind of on that same topic, right? You know, I'm doing direct mail and that's doing okay, right? So they do direct mail, they call in off of a mail piece, it goes to like a call house, they take it, they set up the appointment, then I follow up from there. So I bet and had somebody and went on the appointment, but I wasn't able to get with the decision maker. I went with the daughter instead of the actual father. So
why?
I mean, how do you deal with that?
Why is the daughter protecting the father? Is there a medical reason or?
Yeah, he's just older. He's in his 80s, just not coming around. So I tried to see if we could all get on a call and
it's not going to happen because she's protecting her elderly father who maybe there's dementia or ill health or something. Why is she doing this? She wants to protect dad. So what? Right. So assuming that you're not going to jump over and get to dad, what's the best thing you can do with the daughter?
Just building massive rapport, right?
What could you say to the daughter? I'll be the daughter. Hi, my dad, I'm helping out my dad. He can't really answer calls like this all day long, but I'll be glad to answer any of your questions.
No, that's great. And thank you, Daniel. I appreciate that. Not everybody does that for their dad. It sounds like you really care about your dad. What I'd like to do is make you an offer. You know, today on this property, you guys reached out to us. And so I wanted to get back to you and see what you guys are thinking on this.
That's beautiful. What did Alex do beautifully in the beginning? He did exactly what I was hoping he would do. What did he do? What did he say?
A stroke.
What kind of stroke? What did
stroke.
What did he say to the daughter? It's so nice that you're helping your dad. Not many daughters do that. You know, I think that's so wonderful. I know you're a good person. What happens when you give somebody a sincere... Do you think people do that all day long? What differentiates you in that phone call?
He gave her praise. And
what happens to our mood, our perception, when a total stranger acknowledges us doing something nice for our father or a situation? What do you think is going through their head?
This person is nice.
Christina, say that again. I'm sorry.
Oh, this person is nice.
This is a nice person. Do we like Christina? Do we like doing business with nice people? Yeah. How do we in 30, 60, 90 seconds get someone to say, hey, I got a different person on the phone. I got somebody who's not just rapid fire cross-examining me with a lot of questions. I think I have a nice person here. How many people here talk to customer service people, Verizon, cable companies, electric, water? Okay. What do you think I do? You guys know me pretty well by now. When I get a customer service, a person on the phone, you know, you're on hold, you listen to bad music, and finally get somebody, hello, hello, Verizon, you know, and everything. What do you think's my strategy with that person? What do you think Claude would do?
Hey man, how's your day going? Yeah. You need another cup of coffee? Give them a laugh a little bit.
Yeah. What happens when you acknowledge that person that they're working hard? When you make a joke or something like that? Hey, can I say, hey, you sound like you're working hard. I know it's only 11:16 here in Colorado. Can I send you a virtual margarita? There's something. They laugh. You know, what happens when you make a customer? What is a customer service person here all day long? Anybody here ever do customer service? Do we have anybody in the room who ever had that experience? What's it like, Christina?
Usually they're complaining about what needs to be done and what you need to do for them.
Are they nice to you? Are they polite?
No, most of the time, no. But if you do happen to get someone who's nice to you, you reciprocate that same feeling.
Did you hear what she used? The reciprocate word. How important is it to, when I'm nice to her, Christine is a customer service, can she do a lot of things for me that maybe she wouldn't do for someone who was just very short and rude to me and stuff like that? How important is that to set the mood, to set the environment with total strangers when we're selling? It's huge, isn't it? It's huge. You know, so if I go on the phone, Christina, oh, thank you for taking my call. I have a problem. I bet you're the smartest customer service person there. Maybe you could you help me today? It's driving me and my wife and I crazy, this bill in front of me. You sound like somebody who knows what she's talking about.
Oh, God, Claude. Okay. Let's see what we can do for you.
Oh, great. You are wonderful. Thank you so much. Boom. Have we forgotten?
You're so kind.
Yeah, go ahead.
Oh, you're so kind, Claude. You know what? You're the first nice person I've gotten on the phone all day. It's the mood and the finances. Everyone's just really skippy today. So thank you for the compliment. I appreciate it.
You're having a tough day. You know what? You helped me with this problem. You can take the rest of the day off. Tell your boss I said that, okay?
I'll go relay the message. Thank you, Claude.
can you see someone, when you're on the phone, can you see someone smile? Even though you're on the phone?
Yes.
Can you hear the tonality of their voice sometimes? And when you make someone smile or laugh or like you, what does that do to the whole to the whole scenario, the whole conversation?
It makes it less heavy, for sure.
There's a wonderful book out there. Gary Vaynerchuk wrote Thank You Economy, wrote it about 10 years ago. I think it's the best book, one of the best books ever written on sales. We've forgotten how to acknowledge people. Like, you know, we call them up like robots and stuff. Okay, I want to ask you about your property right now and ask a bunch of questions and everything like that. And you're not the first phone call. And we wonder why they cut us off short or why, well, I can't, call me later or, I don't have the time to answer all your questions. And all of a sudden, they get snippy or short with you. And we don't think about why they read. They're not bad people, but we created that environment by the way we opened up with them. Do you think we need to take responsibilities for the way people respond to us?
Right.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah, absolutely. So this all goes to role-playing and opening the door. Who asked that question? Did I ever answer your question there, Alex?
Well, sort of. We kind of got into the meat of it, right? So I went on the appointment. It was good. Followed up with the offer. I said, I'm get you the offer right away. Got it to them. And they're like, well, the place is probably worth about $550. And I gave an offer at $355. Mm-hmm. And they wanted to, wanted it to be in the 400s. She's like, can you get it up in the 400s? And I said, based on the repairs and everything like that, no. So it's kind of been at a standstill. I've been texting her back and forth, trying to get her back on the line. And it's just, I sent him a repair estimate on some of the repairs to try to justify it. So I'm just trying to get back in the door with this one because I know they're not doing anything with it.
What's their pain, Alex, on a 1 through 10? 10 meaning awful pain, 1 meaning that they could care less. What's their pain and where does it come from?
Man, it's probably like a 3. I mean, they've had this as a Section 8 house for like 30 years. So it's pretty rough.
Oh,
smells pretty funky.
Mr. Wosick, you've had it for how many years? Do you say you've had this Section 8 rental?
Yeah, like 30 years.
30 years? How about another 30? It's a moneymaker for you. There's no problems associated with management or rent, right?
Yeah, I mean, I don't know. We just kind of want to sell it. Equities are high and that kind of jazz.
Well, you just woke up one morning and said you're going to sell it, but you've had it for 30 years. Have it for another 30. It's bringing in great money every month, right? And it's government guaranteed.
It's empty right now.
Oh, that's interesting. Why would it be empty? Rentals are in high demand right now.
Yeah, we're just trying to figure out what to do with it. We want to get, a high-end best offer type of deal.
Or just give it to a realtor or something then, right?
Yeah, I guess we could do that. I don't know. It's kind of up to my dad. He's kind of just sitting on his hands with this thing.
Oh, so your dad's the owner, not you.
Right, yeah. See, yeah, I'm just trying to help out.
Okay, here we go. And then you go, that's so nice you're helping your dad like we did before. What happens when we use that redirection to everybody familiar with the redirection? Show of hands. Everybody know what I mean when I say redirection? Okay, Vic, you're not sure. Vic, I don't know if you're frozen or not. What do I mean by redirection? I mean, go in the opposite expected direction. It's called reverse psychology. Why do I do that? Alex just did a really good role play. Why do I go in the unexpected? Oh, just give it to a realtor or keep the house longer. You don't really want to sell it. Why do I do that? Am I crazy?
No, it gives them a chance to explain themselves, and it gives you a reason or for you why they do need to sell it.
Very good. Excellent.
They give it to you on a silver platter.
Mm-hmm. Does it show you their level of pain as well, Claude? Is that part of the reason you do it?
Well, what did Alex say in that role play? He gave me two tidbits there that I didn't know before. We can't mind read. You know, we call up people, we read our little script, we ask questions. They say they'll think about it or no, and it's over. What the difference about guts is we're trying to get into their soul, into their head, by doing something unexpected. Redirection, stroking, nurturing, to get them to like us. What did Alex give me in that role play? Anybody remember?
Praise.
They're still at a maybe, and he's not the decision maker.
Yeah. We knew he's not the decision maker. So that, and what, you know, maybe it's an elderly parent. Once again, he wants to help. Okay, maybe dad needs the money for retirement or for medical or something like that. We don't know. We're going to find things out like this. And if we can, and the pain, and if we can derive the pain from the son, and what's the son's incentive? Is he going to get a commission or part of the money, or is he just being a good guy and helping out dad? How important is this? How important are these little kernels of information? How important?
Yeah. So how would you ask that? Would you just be like, hey, you know, I think it's great that you're helping out dad. Are you getting like a little bit of commission kind of helping, you know, orchestrate everything, or?
I help dad with his finances. I'm a CPA. Dad's retired and he needs a little bit of extra help and stuff like that. So I told him I'd help him sell the house. And no, I wouldn't charge my dad. He's my dad.
Yeah, likewise. I wouldn't do that either. I think it's good to help and, you know, help him figure it out. So what would you like to see out of this transaction? What would you like to see from an offer? Something like that.
That's beautiful. What would you like to see happen today? What's the perfect?
Yeah. Okay. Good.
That's a great question. You did that beautifully. What happens when we invite them to talk more than us? Who should be talking more? Big mouth Claude or the prospect?
Prospect.
Why?
We need information. We need as much as possible information.
Yes. You think they get emotionally involved when they start talking and telling the story and they like and trust you and they say, my dad's not well, or we need the money or something? Do you start to get that pain, that 1 through 10? Does it start to, maybe you can increase that, maybe go from a 3 to a 6 to an 8? How many different emotional, psychological triggers are in making someone say yes in the first phone call? That's kind of our theme today. Can we close people in one phone call? Can we do that? That's kind of crazy, isn't it? When I say close, I mean, can we set ourselves up for another phone call, an appointment? Can we get a yes or a commitment in one phone call? Can we get some inkling, some idea of, can we close this person in one? And I don't even care if it's a $1 million home. Okay, can we do, or should we just do this? Oh, well, I'll do my research. I'll do my due diligence. I'll call you back in a day or two. Do you get any residual effect when you push it off like that? What do you think, G?
I do that all the time.
do you do that?
You hit me on the head with that one. When I'm ending the phone call, I like to let them know I'm going to follow up within a couple hours or whatever and do some due diligence. And I'll get back with them before the end of the day or something like that.
Okay, well, that's not so bad if you set up a hard appointment. You know,
it's not hard. I'm glad you brought this up because it's not hard. I need to make it hard, though.
But it's challenging, Gonzalo. How did you say your name, sir? I'm sorry, buddy.
You say Gonzalo, but I go by G.
G. All right, G, I like that. Okay, well, good deal. Well, I find that when I give them more time like that, it's hard to get them back on the phone because they got excuses and X, Y, and Z. One of the things I've done that's been working lately is I'm able to just be like, hey, can I just get 5 minutes? I'll call you right back. You know, you can, you know, go to the bathroom and do that. I'll call you right back in 5 minutes. Does that work for you? You got to jet out the house. So people will always say, yeah, that's fine. That's been helping me.
Yeah.
I'd rather get a quick no than a reluctant maybe. I'd rather get no right up front. It's over. We're done. Hey, thank you so much. I appreciate it. Now that, and then you can go gut style. You can then go back in to say, hey, you know, Jessica, now that it's over, I'm going to take off my salesman hat. You take off your home seller hat and everything. How come, you know, what would you really like to see happen on this home? Just before I go.
I want to sell it for the right price. That's what I really want.
And what is that price you need for me to, for us to do business today? What would you need? It's only role play, Jessica. Work that. You don't have to work.
$450,000.
Okay, $450,000.
Yeah.
Okay. And if you got $450,000, what would you say to me next?
Say yes, right here, right now.
Okay, off the role play. I ended the sale. Now that it's over, I went back in the sale, and then listen. Maybe I don't want to pay $450,000, but did I get a commitment from Jessica? Did I get a yes finally?
Yeah.
I mean, I can, here's the rule. You can fix it later. Maybe I want to pay $400,000. Maybe I want to do a lease purchase or something. Can we, once we get these little baby step commitments, do you think we're on our way to closing?
Yes.
So let's talk about fix it. Can we talk about fixing it? So how would you fix that later if you're trying to get 4.25?
I don't know. That's a great question. When you say fix,
you gotta be careful with that, because sometimes that's where real estate agents get a bad reputation, where they you know, entice someone in at a price that they want, and then they beat them down. And I've had that happen. And a couple of times I said, oh, you know what? Just no deal, because you said this and now you're trying to do that.
No, but did you hear my words? I'm very careful. Lawyers use their words very carefully. I said, what price would you need from me in order for us to move forward? Did I make a categorical specific offer? I just asked. No. All I did was ask a question, right? Is that an is a question an offer?
No.
So you can go back and go ahead, get mad at me. Claude, you said 450 and now you're changing everything. Go ahead.
You're moving the goalposts around. I said 450. This is for my dad. He's getting old and he needs the money. And I don't appreciate it when you do that, man.
Jessica? I apologize. It's this New York City accent of mine sometimes. You know, what I wanted to know is what was your bottom line on the price? I didn't make an offer. I was just inquiring what you needed. So I apologize for that miscommunication on that. So okay. That was my bad. Do you forgive me? Give me a second chance.
I do.
Thank you so much.
I forgive you. My price is still $450, and that's my bottom line. Good. Take it or leave it.
Good for you.
Do that right now. We'll close the deal. You ready?
Yep. Can I make you an offer, and you can say yes or no?
Yeah. My bottom number is $450. Take it or leave it.
I'll give
you. I'm gonna walk if you don't.
Okay. I'll give you $450 if you will hold the mortgage for 10 years at 8% interest.
Oh, well, I don't really know all the numbers like you maybe do. Can you explain how that could be mutually beneficial to me a little bit more?
Oh, great question. I wish more people would ask me questions like that. Good for you. Good for you. And the doors, and you can always say no to me. You told me you're helping your dad, you're protecting your dad. Would your dad like a big chunk of money with the tax consequences, or maybe a nice little annuity where money comes in like a Social Security or pension check?
Ooh, so that might help.
So I was thinking maybe this is a good way to give you the price, but give me the terms that I can live with, and also give dad a monthly check. That doesn't make sense, does it?
You know, that really does make sense. That sounds really great.
Good role.
Yeah. I like it. Yeah.
That was a good role play.
That was good. That is good.
That was called We Can Fix It Later. Did I eat a little crow? You know, what would an amateur do? The prospect is mad at you. You said one thing and everything. And the defensive amateur prospect, what will they do? Argue back? I never said that. You're hearing things. You're making up stuff. I don't do business that way. You're accusing me. What happens when you argue with people? Do you get closer or further apart?
No, makes a rift.
What did I do to make it right. To what did I do? It's so easy to do. What did I do?
Apologize.
Agree with her and acknowledge your mistake or whatever you did wrong.
Lo siento. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
I said, I'm sorry. I apologize. Yeah. I said, miscommunicate. I made fun of myself. I got a New York City accent. You know what I'm saying? Here, this isn't coffee. This is coffee. This is coffee. This isn't water. This is water, you know?
So we continue this. So keep going with Jessica here. If she's, you know, maybe she's interested. Yeah, 8% annuity or whatever. So how does that work? Is it, you know, I've heard of like a 30-year amortization. Is it something like that? You know, people say that kind of stuff generally when I get to this point. So how do you keep that going before you send them the agreement?
Everybody here, if you're in real estate, I know most of you are, or whatever business you're in, you have to know of the different solutions. In real estate, you have to understand finance. What's a mortgage? What's an amortization schedule? What is interest rate? Should it be interest only? Should it be principal only? Should it be amortized, interest and principal together? Should it be based on a 30-year amortization, but you do it 10 years with a balloon? You need to learn finance in this business. Because you're going to, she was doing this for her dad. It stands to reason he's a 60, 70, 80-year-old person. Maybe it's free and clear. Okay, so I'll give her the price. I removed the problem. And then I found a different avenue to negotiate with her. So you need to learn so there's a lot of good, study up on finance. If you're in real estate, good book. And listen to that and read that one book from Gary Vaynerchuk, Thank You Economy. It's a very short book. It's only about 100 pages. But there's so much great psychology in that book to getting people to like and trust you or share information. Alex, you asked me a question earlier on, how do you utilize, we can fix it later.
Yep.
And if you remember, you asked me that question and I said, my three favorite words, what are they?
I don't know. I have no idea what you're talking about.
What do amateur people do all the time? I have all the answers to all your questions. I'm just a, why would we act, or this is called feigning ignorance. Why would I act like a dummy? Why? Why does that serve me?
People want to help you out. They want to throw you a lifeline.
Yeah. What happens, a person comes to you on the street, Albert, and hi, Albert, you look like a really nice young man. I am lost. Do you know how do I get to Avocado Lane? Can you help me? I'm so lost and I'm late for an appointment.
Just go down this street right here and then make a right and then make another left and then the Avocado Lane will be right in front of you.
Oh, you're so great. Thank you so much. Sorry to interrupt your day. Boom. What happens when you go to people and say, can you help me? I'm lost. Or you look like a smart person, but blend in a little stroking. What's the response you're going to get from a lot of people?
Usually they're helping.
Yeah. People are, I'm an optimist. The glass is half full. I think people are generally nice. But if you approach them in the same old boring, tired way, you're going to get 99% rejection. Oh God, another one of these investor bottom feeders calling me up again, gonna lowball me a price. And do you realize how bad your competition is? Do you realize how horrible they sound on the phone? How many people here salespeople, others, how many people here listen to other salespeople? What do you, and you hear them on the phone? What goes through your head?
You're like, no. How do I get out of this?
How do I get away from this person? Oh God, leave me alone. Oh, I thought I was on the do not call list. Take me off your, no, you're the 10th person to call. I'm not gonna drop my price. And it's just a bad, are you gonna do business with that person who is already in the first 5 seconds so mad at you because they made an assumption on your character?
Mm-hmm.
So you have to take responsibility and not sound like, your competition is horrible out there. None of the gurus and all the other seminars, all the other motivation and everything, you know, you got to walk tall, walk in the sunshine. And if 1,000 people slam the door in your face and let loose the Rottweilers, you go and knock on another 1,000 doors. Is that reality? Are people really going to do that?
I will. I'll knock on 1,000 doors.
Okay. But that's you, Alex. You, I know you would do that. But
you want to know something crazy? Oh, sorry. Go ahead. Go ahead.
No, yes, go ahead. It's your talk.
So I was getting a property under contract last October. There was people living in the property. The guy lived out of state, whatever. He went dark on me in like December, January. I had an inkling that I needed to go out of state and fly 9 states away. And I knocked on his door and he actually ended up dying on January 23rd. I found out on January 26th. Went through the PR process, helped somebody get elected, got a $200,000 price reduction and bought a property for 18% of market value yesterday. It closed. So I like door.
So is time your friend in business? When you're negotiating your initial presentation, first time you talk to somebody, you worked hard, you spent a lot of money, you told us all about your system and everything, and you finally get that person on the phone. How much time can you afford to waste? Oh, this is great. Let's talk again on Friday. I'll put the paperwork together and I'll get back to you real soon. Do you have that luxury of time with most people? Yeah, you don't. You don't have that time. You've got that magic moment. You guys know, those of you who are my students, you know you just came home from a good date and you're at the doorstep with that other person. And you got that magic moment. What are you going to do? I'll come back next week for that kiss. Okay. Is that what you do?
Go for the gold.
You go for it. You go for it because you're willing. Here's the rule. How many people here have a pen and pad in front of them? Write this down. Real important. 3 words. Ready? Sales. Ready, Christina? Get that pad out. Not you, Jan. You're driving. Sales is
dangerous.
Dangerous. Yeah. It's horrible. Sales is horrible. Why? How does sales affect us? We're getting this rejection and think about it. Said, leave me alone. And when we're getting stuff like that all day long, does that affect us?
Mm-hmm.
Is this thing become a cactus?
Yes.
Do we want to make phone calls when we anticipate that it's going to be either another voicemail or someone who's going to be snippy, nasty to us? Did you ever realize the turnover in salespeople in all professions? Did you ever wonder why? Mm-hmm. It's like they always say it's the highest paid profession in the world. What they don't tell you is the turnover is also just as high.
Mm-hmm.
Why? Because sales is hard. Yeah, sales makes people feel bad unless mm-hmm. they're doing what we're talking about today. How do we have that control? We talked about practice, building confidence, stroking and nurturing to sound different, complimenting, making people smile over the phone, learning how to ask questions and create incentives in people. And that's the key. Role and a question or a role play. Let's go. We got a lot of time here. It's 20 minutes. Let's do some more role plays or anybody have another question? Alex, I don't know, just to go back, I don't know can be one of the best answers you ever give. And then you turn it into a question. Alex, that's a great question. I'm not sure what you mean by that. Could you give me more? Could you tell me what you mean by you want to do a 30-year amortization? I'm not sure what you mean by that. Can you help me out?
Yeah. So essentially I can, so it would be over a 30-year term. See, then it gets all... I want to be able to make it simple because I'm a very intellectual person.
I just say, I don't know. It's a great question. Stroke. I don't know. It's a great question. Did you ask that for a reason? Why did you ask me why the sky is blue? Why did you ask me if I'm having tacos if it's Taco Wednesday? Help me out here a little. I want to help you. So I need to understand better.
Well, I'm curious because, you know, I like the idea of the annuity. It makes sense.
Oh, annuity. The annuities. Can I write this down? Is that all right?
Yeah.
While you're talking, can I write these things down? What am I doing right now? If you're in person or you're on video or even the phone and you tell someone you're going to write, you just said, I don't know. Can you help me? And then you say, I want to write this down. This is great stuff. What's happening?
You're making them feel important.
Yeah.
Because they're writing it down.
Those things important.
Yeah. Socially or in business, Christina, how much will it serve your needs? Go to the bank to make a sale when you make another person feel important or respected.
Oh, it's both socially and business-wise.
Yeah.
Huge. Yeah.
Does anyone have here a friend who these people, I've always been admiring these people who can walk in a room or walk on a stage and instantly, hi, everybody. Hi, I want to pour. Hey, Joe, put down that martini. Does everybody have a friend like that who just walks in a room and lights it up? Does anybody have a friend like that?
Mm-hmm.
You know, they can walk into a restaurant, a bar, they just light up the room. They're so comfortable in their own skin. They're so confident and they put everybody at ease. Isn't that a charismatic behavior? Ooh, that was a $10 word. I've always been in admiration of people like that. How do they do that? They're so relaxed. They're so comfortable. My mom said, don't talk to strangers. and they can do it. So I don't know, Alex, stroke and nurture. Could you help me, please? And not all the time. Nothing I'm telling you is foolproof, but it works so often that your biggest problem would be to keep from laughing when they just say, oh yeah, this is the reason. And they go down a whole list and everything. It's working. It's so great when they give you their motivation, when they give you information. And Jan said it earlier, they're giving it to you on a silver platter. How much easier is it to sell when the prospect is part of the process and sharing information and motivation? How much easier is it?
Yeah, it's working together instead of against each other.
Yeah.
And are we getting them emotionally involved?
Yes.
Okay. But if we just have this logical, intellectual conversation, you know, we just talk about the price, the square footage, the guarantee, the warranty, all the intellectual gobbledygook. Does that make people emotional?
Not as much.
Not really. Not really. Let's go back to you guys. I'm sorry, I jumped over. Who's got a role play or a question? Albert?
Earlier, when you were doing the role play with Jessica, I noticed that you were like kind of emotionally de-escalating her because she got mad at you.
Yeah.
Can we go a little bit more about that? Because I feel like, especially when it's sudden, like you're having some good rapport with them and then they suddenly like get mad at you and they know it's like a negotiation technique.
I love that. I wrote that down. Just what you said. Emotionally de-escalating. I love that. Where did you get that from? That's a great word. Words.
Oh, yeah. I got that from some book I read in sales.
Okay. Emotions. Million-dollar rule. You guys all know it. People make immediate, quick decisions when they get emotional. Okay. Mm-hmm. Emotions are a funny thing. Okay. You know, the difference between love and hate is just a few degrees. It can be one, it can be very, you know, minuscule on this. If someone is mad at you, reasonably mad at you, or maybe she's tired, maybe she, and Jessica in that role play, she got a lot of different phone calls and stuff like that. If you react emotionally and defensively to her, are you going to make a sale? Why are we in business, Mr. Vic?
Make money today.
Amen, brother. How do I get Jessica on my side to like me, to trust me? Arguing with her? I never said that. What are you? You're crazy. I would never say that. Boom, you just lost the sale. So even if she's wrong, you did nothing wrong, but what does it really cost you to de-escalate it emotionally and say, you know what? It's my bad. You're probably right. I probably miscommunicated to you. I apologize. Let me rephrase that. Okay. Are we still friends? Is that all right, Jessica? I'm really sorry.
I guess, you know.
She's a nice one. Did I de-escalate it emotionally? I love that term. I'm going to steal that from you, Vic. You should have sold it to me. When I get Jessica, when I get her to, I'm sorry. It's not that hard to say I'm sorry to somebody, especially on someone that's a total stranger. You'll never talk to him again. You're going to lose the sale anyway. Unless you're dealing with somebody of a really bad character or they're just a mean, nasty person, you don't have to put up with that. But if it's something minor, she heard one thing. You know, sometimes people, they're just tired or something like that. And Can you de-escalate it emotionally by just saying, you know what, you're probably right. I'm so sorry. I should have been clearer about that. You know, can we start all over again? And I'll rephrase that. I apologize. Boom. Did you make it better?
Yes.
And now, do you have a chance to go to the bank, to the Vic National Bank today?
Yes. Yep.
It's not so hard. Is it that hard? Chris Scott, is it that hard?
Oh, is what that hard?
How you doing, Mr. Chris?
I'm good. How are you, Claude?
Good. Keep your eyes on that road, man.
I'm not driving.
Okay, God, your camera's like, ooh. What are you, in California during an earthquake or something?
A lot of potholes in Texas.
There you go. Chris, we were just talking about we can fix it later. You get a prospect who's real mad at you, real emotional. Well, you said $450,000, and I thought that was our price and everything like that. And I'm really getting mad at you. Can you fix it?
I missed a little bit of what you said, but let me fix it. Sir, I'm sorry about that. I understand that you probably you said that you were mad about the price, right, Clark?
Yeah. I thought you said 450, and now you're telling me you said maybe 450 or something else. I'm getting a little tired of these phone calls and you investors.
Yes, sir.
Well, I'm mad.
I understand what you're going. I understand what you're going through, sir. Here's what I propose. When we initially talked about your offer, you didn't tell me that, you know, when I sent my contractors in, there was going to be at about $50,000 in repairs that, you know, we didn't account for. So, you know, I can pay you that, you know, minus the $50,000 in repairs, and I can give that to you in all cash and more. I'd pay you in monthly payments or something like that.
Okay.
How would you feel about that?
Okay, off the role play, because Chris doesn't have a good connection. Did he turn it around and do a counter offer?
Mm-hmm.
How important are counter offers?
Very.
Yeah. Hey, you know what? Suppose, let's imagine, and use these words that I always use. Hey, you know what, Christina, imagine for a moment I could give you the 450, but maybe do it in a different way. How would you feel about it?
Well, what do you mean? Imagine. What are you talking about?
Okay. Thank you for asking. Boom. You got that dialogue thing going.
Yeah.
You got that thing going. Okay. Let's do anybody else. Another Vic. Did I answer your emotion? You're emotionally dissecting. Is that the word?
Dissecting? Yes. Yes. And I really learned a lot from that because I picked up a key word when they're reasonably mad. So it's like, if they're reasonably mad, then you can say, well, you're probably right.
Or there's another way to do it too. Use humor. Anybody mm-hmm. here ever go to a comedy club? Don't you? I love comedy clubs. You go to a comedy club and you laugh for 90 minutes. You have a couple of drinks. How do you feel when you leave that comedy club? You've been laughing for 90 minutes, hopefully good comedians, and you've been laughing and everything. How do you feel? What's your mood?
Happy. Giddy.
Giddy. Do you think the endorphins are jumping up and down in your body? You feel happy.
Yeah.
Good.
Feel happy.
So sometimes use humor. Make fun of yourself. Self-deprecating humor. Vic, you sound like you're really mad at me. I'm sorry. Whatever I said, I always say silly things and everything like that. Or is it maybe it's time to switch to decaf? You've been drinking a lot of coffee today.
I drink a lot of coffee too.
Yeah. That, by the way, comedy can also backfire on you sometimes. It can really backfire, but at least you're going down with a fight on it. So if you want to save a deal, anybody here have a situation where you just had a bad impression on the person? It didn't go the way. And then they said or did something that enamored you to that person. They turned it around.
Yeah.
You know? Study charismatic. What do charismatic people do to get total other people to like and trust them? This is the way you can close in the first phone call. Another role play. We need more role plays today. Who wants the role play? Go ahead.
I get a lot of so I usually do lease assignments, and usually I get the, well, who are you leasing it out to? I don't want to work with investors. That sounds silly.
I don't blame you, Christina, but investors. Oh, huge. I don't, I'm an investor and I don't even want to work with myself. I know how you feel. Oh, so is it over? I mean, I'm an investor. I mean, what is, are we done? Is it over?
Oh, just like that?
Just like that. I mean, she told you she doesn't like investors. You said that, right? I mean,
right.
We're going real fast downhill here. I mean,
oh, yeah.
I don't like investors. You're all the same. You're all bottom feeders and everything. Make a joke of it. You're right. You know, my wife said the same thing to me this morning.
I think you push her closer when you agree with her. Oh, yeah, I hate investors. Oh, man, gosh.
Yeah. I'm in a 10-step program. I'm in Investors Anonymous. I'm in a 10-step program right now. I'm, you know, have fun. Don't take it so serious. They're just people like you and me. And if you can hit that chord, she's been when you play that too well, Christina, when you get people, you've experienced people like that, obviously, right?
So many times.
Why are they behaving like that? Do you ever ask yourself that?
Well, I usually get the, oh, I'm so sorry. Well, why exactly? And then they go with, well, I've gotten so many calls from and texts from investors like you. Oh.
Annoying. Aren't we annoying? Aren't we the worst? Oh, my God. So even if I said I wanted to make you an offer today and buy your property or sell you the property, or even if we could do business today and become lifelong friends, it wouldn't be worth us staying on the phone for another minute, right?
Well, I don't know. Are you actually seriously doing an offer, or are you just talking about it? Because if we're just talking about it, I don't really want to do anything today.
I don't blame you. I feel the same way. No, I'm very serious. That's why I'm calling you today. And it sounds like you're having a tough day, so I'll be real brief. If I could ask you 2-3 quick questions just to learn more about the property and everything, I'll make you an offer and you can say yes or no. Is that fair?
Yeah, that sounds
fair. Oh, you're being so reasonable. Thank you. Boom. Stroke, nurture, ask questions, apologize, whatever it takes to get back into the dialogue. Why is she lashed? And you did that real too well, Christina. Why is Christina, who playing this irritated owner, why is she lashing out at me? Why is she behaving like that? She never spoke to me before. Why am I her whipping boy?
Her past experiences have led her to that point.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. Yeah. Let's do something different before we run out of time here. I want to do a role play. I want someone to close me in one phone call. I'm a very motivated seller. I have a million dollar property and I want to sell it for $750 because I'm getting divorced and I have to get out of East Bumble, Florida real fast. Someone close me in one phone call. Who's my investor today? Michael, Mr. G? Anybody? Albert? Go ahead, G. Hello, this is Motivated Claude.
Have we spoken before?
Huh? Who are you?
Have we spoken before? I'm just
called me.
Off the rope. Have we spoken before or no?
First phone call, motivated seller, $1 million condo, I want to sell it fast and get out of Dodge. Highly motivated. On a 1 through 10, I'm a 10. We don't have to monkey around here. Just I want you to close me in one phone call.
All right.
And you don't have I'll throw a monkey wrench in here. You don't have the $750,000.
Oh.
All right, let's do it.
Hello. Ring, ring. Hello, Claude. Hey. Hello, Claude, the motivated seller.
Hey, Claude. Hope you're doing good. This is G. I got a question for you. That beautiful house that's got that for sale sign on there, you sold that already, right?
No, it's still available. It's $1 million property. Check the appraisal on Zillow. I'm just looking to sell it fast for $750. No fooling around.
Oh, so you mean if I can write you an offer for $750 today, we got a deal?
Yeah, can you do that? Or when you one of those, I was just talking with Christina. She's been getting all these bottom feeding investors here. Are you one of those losers?
I might be Claude, but I don't. Some people think I'm a loser, but I like to think myself a little bit more. But
I didn't expect that one. You're a nice person. You wouldn't really say that, would you?
I got to agree with you a little bit.
Now you got me defending you.
So we're working.
So Claude, so you won $750,000. Gosh, Claude, let me tell you something. Suppose we do that today, and I'll write a contract up. I'll send it to you before in the next hour or two. What do you say next?
Yes, you can do $750,000. Can we close? Listen, I need to get out of East Bumble, Florida, and move back to Milwaukee.
To Milwaukee?
Yeah.
Oh, okay. And how soon do you need to move?
Yesterday. I want to get out of here, and I just want to sell this home fast. And that's why I discounted it so much.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, it's $750,000.
Can you close by August 15th?
I'm going to have to, gosh, I got so much stuff going on. I got other stuff I'm working on. August
15th. Guys, listen, I don't have the time for this. Thanks a lot.
Yeah, no, Claude, I can move some stuff. All right, it's over.
It's over, baby. You got to read. Have you ever had these people hang up on you or just you said one wrong word, click? I have.
Yeah.
Okay. Why can't you take yes for an answer?
I don't know, man. Okay. It was too easy.
Okay. Right, get the deal, write up the deal. And even if you don't have the money, what's the next move you're going to make? You got a contract on a $1 million property for $750,000. Can you make money on this? Of course. But you don't have the money. So you have a problem. He's got a problem and you've got a problem. How do you solve it? What do?
You find investors, maybe?
Hello, Claude the investor. Hello?
Who takes over?
Hello?
Hey, Claude, I got a property right here. I got a property right here. I'm willing to, see if you're interested in doing it. Do you have an opportunity to make about $100,000 a day?
Oh, really? $100,000 today?
Yep.
Yeah, I'm very interested.
Yeah, so I got a contract right here. I got it for $750,000. I'm willing to just, actually make about $50,000 on this. So I can sell it to you for $800,000. You can make $200,000 or you can make $100,000 because I got somebody else lined up right now.
Well, I'm confused. First you said $100,000, then you said $200,000. This sounds like a scam.
Well, Claude, it might be a scam, but I got another person.
Goodbye, click. I'm sorry, Vic. I'm being real nasty. What was the mistake you made in the very beginning when you said that 100,000 number?
I didn't do the numbers correct. Yeah.
Yes. What happens when you don't get your numbers correct in a serious negotiation? What happens to your credibility? Do they get nervous when sometimes you start backpedaling or you do corrections and stuff? How important is assertiveness and confidence when you're speaking to someone on a quickie phone call and you're hitting their emotional greed button? How important is it?
Very. Very.
What's Elon Musk doing to Twitter right now?
Yeah.
What is he doing? I don't want to use bad language, but read my mind, okay? Because I don't like to use, but what is Elon Musk doing to Twitter right now?
He's pushing back really hard, you know? I mean, are you saying he's manipulating or?
Oh God, yes. Who's in control, Twitter? Or Mr. Musk?
No, he is.
He is totally in control in everything. Yeah, go ahead, sue me.
Is he validated in what he's saying, though, do you think?
I don't know what's in his mind. He either wants to get out of the deal completely because of this recession that's coming and pick it up for pennies on the dollar later on, or he wants a better price, or he just totally wants to get out of the deal completely. I don't know what he's... I think it's one of those three things, but what is he doing? Who's in control and who's reacting?
He's in control in their reaction.
By the way, Twitter said today in the Wall Street Journal, they're going to sue him for breach of contract. Here's a little bit of law for you guys. When you sue somebody, what do you open up for the whole world to see?
It is a picture.
You open up all your numbers, all your stats, all your records. You open up every, when you sue somebody, you open up Pandora's box and reveal everything. Okay, so somebody else got the, you got the contract. Someone closed me in one phone call. You got the contract for $750. It's worth $1 million. Someone closed me. Want 60 seconds. Go ahead.
Okay. Is that Claude the investor?
Yeah, Claude
the investor. Hey, Claude, you know, I found this amazing property. I'm not in a position to buy it myself right now, but I think you are. Yes. And it's a $1 million property. It's worth $750. I mean, they want to sell for $750, sorry. I thought it would be a really good fit for you. It's in Bumble, Florida, you know. I know you love that part of town.
Is that East or West Bumble, Florida?
Well, which place do you like the best?
I like them both, frankly. How am I going to make money on this? I'm a greedy capitalist investor. How do I make money on this?
Well, I'd be willing to sell it to you for $800,000.
Well, how much did you get it for?
At $750. So I just need to make a little bit for myself.
That's a lot of money. You just got this. I'm looking at the date of the contract. You just got this last Friday.
Yep. Yeah. I want to move along quickly. I got some bills to pay and I'm getting married soon. I need to pay for the wedding. And I just want to make a quick little bit of money. I do have some other investors that might be interested if you're not, but you're my first call. So
What's the least you take? I like the property. What's the least you take to do a deal today?
How about 775. Did I get my numbers right?
Yeah, yeah. So you're going to make $25,000. That sounds reasonable. I'll tell you what. Let's do that. I'll give you $25,000 when we close.
Okay. Ooh. Joseph, but I need a deposit though.
Joseph, tell her why you're shaking your head, Joseph.
Need a deposit. Okay.
Money first, money today.
Oh, okay. Would you do a deposit though, right? Wouldn't you? You wouldn't get the whole money up front.
I don't care. Well, is there anything wrong with getting all the money up front? Since you dropped from 50 to 25, should we utilize something called reciprocity? Robert Cialdini. What's reciprocity? Somebody explain, define reciprocity. What is it?
Give both ways, give and take.
Give and take, yeah.
Yeah,
You just gave up $25,000. Are you now in a power position to demand getting paid today?
Okay.
Let me hear that. I'll tell you what. Yeah. If you can drop it from 800 to 775, you make 25,000. I get the property. I can live with that.
Okay, great. Can we? I would need the money today to confirm your commitment there, though.
All the money?
Yes.
Wow. I don't know.
Just about because I've dropped my price, and so we would need to. We want to make it go quickly.
Okay, off the roll plate. What you just said now was great, but you should have said it 30 seconds ago. And you struggled a little. You struggled.
Okay.
You know what, Claude? You're asking me to drop from 50,000 profit to 25. That's a big jump lower. If I was willing to do that, would you be ready to pay me 25,000 right now? Do you have that available?
Okay, I see. Okay.
Boom. Did you see the difference?
Yeah.
What did we learn today? Somebody tell me, did we learn anything today other than I talk fast?
What would you like to see happen today? That's fire right there. That's gold.
Mm-hmm. What did you learn today, Christina?
Get paid today.
Amen, sister. Get paid today. Albert, what did you learn?
Sales is dangerous.
Tails is dangerous because it can affect
how if you got your blonde head on.
Yeah,
you gotta get your numbers right.
Yeah, gee, Mr. G, what did we learn today?
Go for the kiss. Take yes for an answer.
And never, what was it you said earlier about being a loser or something? Do we all? Do we ever say
that? I didn't learn that part to say no.
Yeah, Michael Seville, we didn't see your handsome face there. We saw your caricature. What did you learn today, Michael?
He's on the beach right now.
He's on the pond. He's in Palm Beach. Edward Claspy, did we learn anything? Nothing. Okay. Anyway, you guys have a Jan Guzman. There he goes.
I always learn when I listen in on you, my friend, always.
I learn from other people too every day. I read books. I listen to people who are smarter than me. I really try to I love biographies. You guys hear me quote Elon Musk? That guy, he fascinates me. He's such a winner. He uses his authority and power in ways that are just amazing to me. He stuck his nose up at the state of California. Hey, we're going to do it my way. Okay, goodbye. I'm going to Texas. I'm going to build a billion dollar SpaceX project down there. Give them a lot of jobs and everything. Bye bye, California. Is that arrogance, authority, or confidence? Or all the above?
Confidence.
Actually, all the above.
All the above.
All of the above. Yeah. Choose your heart today, guy. Choose your heart today, guys. You said, Alex.
Yeah. So sales is hard, but being broke is hard. You know, eating right is hard, but you know, being out of shape is also hard. So choose your heart. Yeah. You know.
Absolutely. You guys enjoy your summer. Be safe out there. Stay cool. And thanks for joining Role Play Wednesday. A lot of fun. Thank you.
Can you put, please, name of this book you mentioned, Gary?
Gary Vaynerchuk, Vaynerchuk. Thank you, Economy. Brilliant little book. Yeah, and he's on YouTube. He's a little abrasive. He uses a lot of F-bombs and stuff like that. You overlook that. There's some genius in, other than that, there's some real genius in there. Anybody a Gary Vaynerchuk fan? I mean, I think he's brilliant on so much of what he said has affected the way I do marketing. You guys know, when I do marketing, I believe in attraction marketing rather than chasing and bothering people. I'd rather have a few quality. And his whole book is based on attracting people through social media. And Thank You Economy is about acknowledging people and making them feel good. And when they feel good, maybe they'll say yes. Bye-bye, guys. Have a good day.
Bye-bye. Thank you. Thank you.
Bye-bye.
Keep you away.
Let's go out with a little Men at Work.